Good evening, online viewers, and I am thankful for doctors who are attending my lecture on today onwards, and thanks for online viewers also for watching my lecture. Our today's topic is pulmonary embolism. So firstly, I am going to explain you what does it mean. Pulmonary embolism means when any blockage when blockage in bronchial artery or and its branch, any branch, due to clot which travels from somewhere and is stuck inside a bronchial artery or any its branch is known as embolism, and it's known as pulmonary. P represent here pulmonary, E represent here embolism, my dear friends. Okay, doctors, so today I decide to change my pattern of study, and I'm going to ask questions and then I'm going to explain this topic. First, it's necessary for us to know the lecture, what does it mean by pulmonary embolism. So my dear friends, my first question. In PG, December 2005, they ask a question in PGI Chandigarh. There is a multiple answers, right? So they ask the risk factor for pulmonary embolism. We already know the what is pulmonary embolism. Now I written here RF represent here risk factor. So we are going to learn a higher option. A is 30 year female on OCPs. Second one is pregnancy. Third one is leg paralysis. Fifth option is 50 year person with uncomplicated cholecystectomy. And E1 is Behçet's disease. So if I ask accept, so my question goes to Dr. Mohan.
D.
Yes, he is right. If we put here accept, then answer goes to be D. Why? Because if a female is 30 year and she took OCP, OCP's taker is a risk factor, OCP user is a risk factor for pulmonary embolism. B option here is pregnancy. Yes, pregnancy is also a risk factor. Why pregnancy? Because it's pregnancy, a female take a bad rest, she can't move so much, that's why pregnancy is also a risk factor. And leg paralysis, why risk factor? Because no movement. When leg paralysis, he is always sitting, so it's a risk factor for pulmonary embolism. Leg paralysis, my dear friends, my dear doctors. And here D option, uncomplicated cholecystectomy, no problem. After cholecystectomy, he can walk after 24 hours, because I already seen so many patients after cholecystectomy, they are walking easily. Okay. Then here one option is Behçet's disease. Yes, Behçet's disease is also Behçet's disease. Why? Have you ever heard the name of Behçet's disease? So I am going to explain. Behçet's disease is nothing but small vessels vasculitis. Vasculitis topic I am going to explain in my another task in my next coming videos. So my dear friends, we easily done this question. So risk factor, you remember, I decide to teach you in that manner what kind of question they are asking and how we need to know. Okay, another question. The most common source of pulmonary embolism is, first option is amniotic fluid embolism, renal artery embolism, large vein of legs, and cardiothoracic surgery. So my dear friends, I already written the most common source of pulmonary embolism. The most common source of pulmonary embolism here is the DVT. I am going to write you. The DVT is the most common source which causes the pulmonary embolism. So it's known as the deep vein thrombosis. So here the option large vein of leg is a right answer. Okay. Another question. In AIMS 94, all are true about pulmonary embolism except pulmonary embolism. First option is chest pain is the most common symptom in pulmonary embolism. Yes, there is a chest pain, but this one is not a most common symptom in pulmonary embolism, because the most common symptom of pulmonary embolism is dyspnea, my dear friends. dyspnea, D-Y-S-P-N-E-A, here not mentioned. In this option, so we easily rule out chest pain is not the most common symptom. Most commonly present within 2 weeks. Yes, it's pulmonary embolism may be present within 2 weeks, right? More is the survival time, more is the chance of recovery. If patient with pulmonary embolism survives longer, that means the recovery going to be longer. Okay. Areas arises from leg bends. Yes, I already explained DVT. Okay, the next question. D-dimer is the most sensitive diagnostic for in AIMS May 2005. They asked this question. So it's very easy. Pulmonary embolism, A option. B is acute pulmonary edema. C is cardiac tamponade. And D1 is acute myocardial infarction. My question goes to Dr. Vijay. Answer
A.
Yes, he is right. Pulmonary embolism, no doubt. So, my dear friends, if we want to rule out the pulmonary embolism, we need to go for best is D-dimer is for pulmonary embolism, my dear friends. So remember D-dimer. Okay, it's the best investigation. Then another question. In AIMS November 2005, the most definitive method of diagnosing the pulmonary embolism is, option are, listen carefully, option is A, pulmonary arteriography, B is radioisotope perfusion pulmonary syncytiography, C is EKG, and D is venography. My question goes to Dr. Sachin.
A.
Yes, his Sachin is right here. Pulmonary arteriography is the most definitive. I already written here, definitive is pulmonary, PI represent pulmonary arteriography. It's in the arteries, arteriography is the most convenient and most definitive investigation. Okay, my dear friends, another question. Best investigation when there is a clinical suspicion of pulmonary embolism in a patient, AIMS 2007 November. Best investigation when there is a clinical suspicion of pulmonary embolism is this. Listen carefully a question. Option A is D-dimer assay, which we know is the best investigation. Option B is a multi-detector CT angiography. Option C is Doppler ultrasonography. Option D is catheter angiography. So, my dear friends, here the question is, answer is multi-detector CT angiography is the best clinical assess. Repeat. Okay. True about pulmonary embolism. Okay, listen carefully. Questions. In ECG shows right ventricular strain pattern. B option is difference in normal partial pressure of oxygen. ECG also shows typical S1, Q3, T3 pattern, my dear friends. And D option is not a medical emergency. My question goes to Madan.
A.
Yes, he is right. He is again right. So here ECG shows the right ventricular strain pattern. Yes, ECG shows right ventricular strain pattern, my dear friends, and also Q1, S3 and T3 presentation is most common in ECG. ECG Q1, S1, Q3 and T3, my dear friends. Here is S1, Q3 and T3 presentation seen on ECG. So till here, I hope no problem. You understand what kind of question they are like to ask. So there is a very, very basic knowledge they like to ask. Okay, after the completion of these questions, I am going to explain you the pulmonary embolism in briefly again, and we are going to solve some questions now. Most diagnostic investigation in pulmonary embolism is option A, angiography. Option B, no need to, only angiography is the best initial and the best investigation. So another question, pulmonary embolism is most commonly produced by which of the following? Most common, A option is trauma, B option is atherosclerosis, C option is thrombosis of pelvis vein, PGI. 2005 they asked. So I already explained. Also repeated question. They every year they just change the language and nothing else they are doing. They are asking repeatedly. 50% I think, my dear friends, questions are repeatedly asking. Thrombosis of pelvis vein. Yes, I already explained DVT, deep vein thrombosis. So this was the answer. No need to be think so much about this topic. You are going to get such a easy answers. I am just explaining. Most reliable investigation in diagnosis of pulmonary embolism is angiography. Again, repeatedly asking 2005 JIPMER. Okay, another one. What is the definitive method of diagnosis pulmonary embolism? In UPSC 2006, what they are doing, guys, pulmonary angiography. No need to check even question. So I hope my theory is sufficient. Okay, another one. Wells grading of pulmonary embolism is based on first one they ask Doppler. Second option is clinical symptoms. Third option is hemoptysis. Fourth option is heart rate more than 100 per minute. So my dear friends, I am going to explain what is the Wells criteria and what does it indicate. It's very important. It's very, very important to know. Wells criteria. Name Wells. W-E-L-L-S. Wells criteria for pulmonary embolism or grading. And I am going to explain what they include and why we need this Wells. If patient has DVT, then it's 3 DVT. When patient suspected pulmonary embolism, also include 3. If patient has tachycardia more than 100, it includes also 1.5. It include 1.5. And if patient has hemoptysis cuff with blood, hemoptysis is include 1 in grading. And if patient has malignancy include 1.0. So it's 1, my dear friends. If patient has surgery or immobilization 3 days, it's tech 1.5. this is include the Wells criteria. And how to use Wells criteria? It's a most logical question. Okay, we include more than 4 or less than 4 criteria we are going to use for Wells classification. If we suspect a patient has less than 4, then we are need to go D-dimer. If any surgery or we suspect some symptoms, if D-dimer is normal, then think about another disease. If D-dimer is positive, think here, yeah, it's less than 4 then. And it's more than 4. It's known as dichotomous pulmonary. Dichotomous pulmonary embolism investigation procedures. If less than 4, maybe DVT, only DVT. So we need to rule out the pulmonary embolism, only pulmonary embolism, Dichotomous criteria for treatment also. So if it is normal, no, think about another disease. If it will come positive, think about the criteria, include more than 4. More than 4, then we need to go for helical CT. Helical CT, my dear friends, helical CT. And then we need to go for pulmonary angiography, which I already explained, or VQ scan. So my dear friends, I hope you understand till here. And I'm going to told you, what is D-dimer? Have you ever heard D-dimer? D-dimer is an investigation. Everybody knows it's not a great idea. So I'm going to explain. D-dimer is the level breakdown products of the clot. When the clot is breakdown, it is the product, remaining product of the clot. Okay, now Wells grading is clear. Then gold standard diagnosis of pulmonary embolism. Again, same questions they like to ask in the different languages. I am already tired. In 2009 February, PG, I Chandigarh, pulmonary angiography or arteriography, you can say, my dear friends, angiography. Okay, another question. A 20-year-old male present with acute and onset of respiratory distress and tachypnea. His blood pressure is 90/60. Loud P2 is present. True about his condition. So, my dear friends, very easy. We need to do D-dimer assay. Yes, we need to do D-dimer assay. Yes. Another option, increased saturation is seen. How? Not possible. S wave in lead 1 and Q wave in lead 3 of ECG is seen. I already explained the ECG finding S1, Q3 and T3, my dear friends. So, S wave in lead 1 and Q wave in lead 3 in ECG is seen. And streptokinase should be given. Yes.
A.
Yes, he is right. D-dimer is right. And these are also right. Okay. So, here we are not going to choose only A. Answer is C and D also. Okay. Prophylactic measure of DVT includes. Option A is warfarin. B is heparin. C is graduate. Electric compression, stocking, pneumatic compression devices and dextran. So, here they like to ask a question. About treatment. So pulmonary embolism we are going to treat by, okay, I am going to remove this Wells reading duster, and then let's came for treatment. Come again. So you see, my dear friends, how repeatedly they like to ask the questions. Nothing new, no questions for them. If you know this theory, repeatedly same questions they are like to put again. Every year they like to put same questions and nothing new if we are going to know about from this topic. Okay, then treatment we can give warfarin. Yes, warfarin if we give, we need to measure INR. What is INR? INR is an international normalized ratio. That must be okay, normal range. Then heparin we can use. Yes, heparin, low molecular weight heparin we can use. And compression stocking. Why stocking? Because it also prevents the clot formation. Pneumatic compression devices also, no problem. The most common symptom of pulmonary embolism, I already written here, dyspnea, my dear friends. It's dyspnea, no chest pain. Most common investigation of pulmonary embolism is, again they asked me such a question. They asked, so think about, this is the most important question. Definitive investigation pulmonary arteriography, remember this from this video. This is also sufficient sometimes because it's repeatedly so many times in every year they like to ask in a different ways, different manners. The treatment most likely to benefit the patient of massive pulmonary embolism in shock, Karnataka 2012. If patient in a shock and massive pulmonary embolism, so listen carefully. Option A is thrombolytic therapy. Option B is inotropic agent. Option C is vasodilator therapy. Option D is diuretic therapy. So my question goes to Dr. Mohan. Answer please.
B.
Okay. Then Dr. Vijay, answer please.
A.
Yes. This time Dr. Vijay win the race and he is absolutely right. We need to go for thrombolytic therapy, my dear friends. In this situation, if it is a massive pulmonary embolism, but Dr. Mohan, you need to work hard and you need to wake up in my class. It's better. Study more. 60-year-old male, hypertensive, had a stroke 2 weeks prior, sudden attack of dyspnea. The present ECG shows S1, Q3 and T3. I already written here. S1, Q3 and T3 represents pulmonary embolism, sudden onset of this question. Ventilation and Q pulmonary scan shows major areas of reduced perfusion. What is the probable diagnosis? I already explained. This is a pulmonary embolism, nothing else. No need to think about anything. No need to watch any options. Okay, last question. In JIPMA 2013, prompt heparin therapy, true statement about pulmonary embolism. Now we know so many things about pulmonary embolism. Now, heparin therapy will dissolve thrombi, A option. B option, non-risk factor include gastric cancer and AIDS. C option is most patient manifest dyspnea, pain, hemoptysis. And D1 is free-floating iliofemoral thrombi are an indication for Cavaware filter. My dear friends, here I think so many right answers. Like heparin therapy will dissolve thrombi, I don't think so. Non-risk factor include gastric Known, known, K-N-O-W-N means known. Risk factor include gastric cancer and AIDS. I already explained this. Malignancy also a risk factor. Okay. Most patient manifest dyspnea, pain and hemoptysis. Yes, dyspnea is the most common symptom. I hope this is right also. Free floating iliofemoral thrombi can an indication of Furukawa filter. It's not an indication, my dear friends. Okay, so my lecture is over. I decided to do a lecture in such a manner. So again repeat. Now see me and don't see anywhere. Concentrate. I'm going to explain everything very easily and short manner, my dear friends. So listen. What is pulmonary embolism? Pulmonary embolism, when there is a blockage in bronchial artery or any of its branch, is known as embolism, pulmonary embolism, its definition. Then if we want to know about the sign and symptoms of this disease, then sign, symptom, most common symptom is dyspnea. Dyspnea, shortness of breath, my dear friends, tachypnea, tachycardia, hypotension, chest pain, fever, pleuritic effusion. These all are the symptoms, or sudden death also. Very sad situation. A person can die very immediately. And what are the risk factors? Risk factor is obesity. Deep vein thrombosis is the most common risk factor. A patient has a history, female patient has a history of OCP users, pregnancy, traveling history, like a travel in a car for 9 hours, travel in a flight for 12 hours. So these are the risk factor. Prolonged sitting. Why prolonged sitting is a risk factor? Because the clot making that time, and he if you want to do some exercises, the clot will dissolve easily, but that clot will travel and stuck in bronchial artery at that time, my dear friends. MI, malignancy, these are the risk factors. So I already explained Wells criteria. So Wells criteria, remember my dear friends, if 3 points, if more, less than 4 points, if we know the, I already told here the classification, if less than 4, then we can go for D-dimer. If D-dimer is negative, no need to do nothing. If D-dimer is positive, we need to go for further investigations, and it comes under more than 4 criteria. So we need to do a spiral CT, and after that spiral CT we need to do for pulmonary arteriography, angiography. So repeatedly asked, what is the best initial test? D-dimer. If you suspect, if D-dimer is negative, think about another disorder. Okay, my dear friends, and treat, how to treat this, treat the cause. Cause here is a clot, and embolus happens, DVT is the cause. So go for low molecular weight heparin, warfarin, and in severe cases we need to go for alteplase. Understand, my dear friends? And what are the other risk factor, like post-traumatic, and Batchet's disease, I already explained. And virtue trade, remember virtue trade, my dear friends, it's very important. Stasis, blood vessel stasis here, blood vessel stasis, hypercoagulability, and there is a damage of vessels, endothelial vessels damage, my dear friends. So I hope you understand this pulmonary embolism. Today I decided to teach you in a different manner. If you like this way of teaching, so please suggest me the different ways, how should I improve my lectures for you, that will help you. Okay, my dear friends, have a good day, good night. Thank you, my dear friends. That's all.